The other great synthesizer was Ronald Reagan. He was able to take what Buckley had synthesized in those three groups, the anti-communists, the libertarians, and the traditionalist Catholics mostly, and he was able to add two significant groups to them. Ronald Reagan's campaign, actually starting in 1976, in his first run for the presidency, was able to bring aboard the neoconservatives, and I'm talking about the original neocons from the 1960s. These were mostly Jewish intellectuals who were writing in commentary, who had grown disillusioned with the liberal tradition, and you know they saw the protests in Vietnam going way overboard. They were discontent with the violence on campuses. They were discontent. They could not believe the way liberalism was responding to the civil rights movement. There was no order in the streets. It had been ham-handedly handled some of the most pressing issues in our country at that time. So the neocons come over, again, mostly Jewish intellectuals in the 1960s. They have a home in Ronald Reagan and in the pages of National Review. The second group that Ronald Reagan brings aboard for the first time are the evangelical Christians. Now, Jimmy Carter is the first president to capitalize on the evangelical Christian vote. Remember, he gives the interview in Playboy magazine? He says, Rosalind knows that I've had lust in my heart. Remember that? Mm-hmm. Well, Jimmy Carter turned out to be more liberal than the evangelicals were comfortable with, and so they really came home to Ronald Reagan in 1980 and stuck with him. So that's five groups now that are unified, very disparate groups. If you take libertarians and evangelical Christians and traditional Catholics and anti-communists, they're very disparate groups who are now able to live in the same tent. But it's the force of the ideas, it's the force of the ability to communicate. The very things that Randall and Derek and Andy and other speakers have emphasized, it's the ability to master those ideas, it's the ability to communicate them and to speak to a larger audience that made this possible. Who's going to be the next Ronald Reagan? Who's going to be the next William F. Buckley? Who can take these disparate groups and through sheer force of intellect and charisma and personal courage, this stuff takes courage, to get in the marketplace of ideas and say, we need to pull this together. Who is that going to be? Is it somebody in this room? Well, if you ask the question, who's it going to be, this leads to the question of sources of renewal. How do we renew what seems to be a house of conservatism that's in a bit of a shambles right now? It's fallen on hard times. One source of renewal, I'm going to give you three of them. One source of renewal is to go back and master the literature produced by these lions, these great lions in the post-war era. The Russell Kirks, the Frank Myers, the Hayeks, the Friedmans, the Weavers. Read the books, absorb the ideas. I heard such an interesting comment the other day that if you look at the presidential candidates right now and there's all this talk about plagiarism, it's because they have no time to reflect and truly absorb new ideas and think through the ideas that they have no time to read. So they're just absorbing in ambiently what they hear. Well, no matter how busy we are, and gosh, I know, I've raised three kids, I've had busy jobs, but no matter how busy we are, we have to take time to read and to study these classics. Now, when we do that, I don't think the answer is that we try to become little William F. Buckley's or little Russell Kirk's. We'll never succeed. These people are sui generis. They were great, great individuals, and I wouldn't try to imitate them because, I mean, they're irreplaceable. It's like a house. Say if you want to build a colonial house, and you've been to Colonial Williamsburg, and you think, I want a house that looks like that. You're not going to literally build George Wythe's house from Colonial Williamsburg. You're going to put in HVAC, you're going to have modern plumbing, you're going to have a modern foundation, you're going to be watching out for termites in the way they could. It's the same for us. We want to rebuild the house. We want to make the house sound. But we have to do it by adapting it to what we know the situation, our historical truth here. We've gotten through the Cold War. We live in a different era. We face different enemies. We know things that people writing the 1950s did not know just because things have happened. Our whole relationship to Islam is totally different from what anybody anticipated in 1950. That makes our world different. We read A Road to Serfdom, or A Socialism by Ludwig von Mises, or Memoirs of a Superfluous Man by Albert J. Nock. We read them for the first principles that are in the book. What are the first principles that we can apply? Because the first principles are going to be ratified by historical experience. And once you can extract what that historical experience and the first principles are, you can apply it to today without slavishly trying to be a Russell Kirk or William F. Buckley. You can be creative and analytical and interesting in the way you deal with these ideas and adapt them to your challenges. Everybody here working or in grad school, working with these ideas and facing a new generation of challenges.
Yeah.